machine learning projects, sharing my personal experiences as well as some of the experiences I have collected over the years from world-class machine learning practitioners like Andrew Karpathy, Jeremy Howard, Andrew Ng, and so on. I would, of course, expect intermediate level of machine learning familiarity if you want to get the most out of this stuff. And also, I'll be sharing my take with all of you. So you may not want to click pictures or snaps if you want to, because you will be getting them anyway towards the end of my talk, so that we could, you know, solely focus on the discussion and you know to be able to make it interactive. So after my talk gets ended, if there's some time, I'll be welcoming questions and I'll try my best to answer. So let me just go through the agenda of this talk. I'll start by introducing the life cycle of a machine learning project to keep everyone on the same page. Then we'll hit directly the topic, why we should care about the structure. Then of course we'll jump towards some ways with which a machine learning project can be structured. We'll be discussing several ways, of course. Then we'll discuss some future steps to further improve these decisions, and then we'll go. So without any further ado, let's just get started. So nothing very fancy here. I'm sure the ones that do machine learning on a regular basis are all familiar with these steps. They should be familiar. So a machine learning project typically starts with problem understanding. You should be really understanding the problem, otherwise you'll be able to take the downstream decisions really. So your problem understanding gives birth to further tasks, such as what data you should be collecting to support your problem, to represent your problem better. Then you would pre-process and rank in the data set and so on. Then you would spend some time to understand this data as to what this data is trying to convey. Can you derive some insights from the data just by looking at it, and so on. Then you'll of course begin the favorite part of the entire process, that's machine learning modeling process. Then you typically evaluate your machine learning model and you tune its hyperparameters. Then you repeat some steps to converge to a workable model. Then you deploy the model and you would typically monitor the entire process, and you would again go back to retraining it and evaluating it and further tuning it, and so on. You note the steps are highly summarized, and these are typical steps. And by typical, I essentially mean that these steps may not always be sequential, but these steps do give us a very nice overview of an end-to-end of the life cycle of an end-to-end machine learning project. So moving along, let's just cut it right away to the need of structuring a machine learning project. So I borrowed this picture from Andrew's course, Andrew's deep learning specialization. So the main point is applied machine learning and deep learning is iterative. It is not very common that in the first go you will be able to get a highly workable model. You will have to iterate through the process to finally converge or to include things like lots of experimentations, lots of hyperparameter tuning, and others. So let's just discuss a bit more about all of these points that I have specified over here. So as I mentioned, applied deep learning and machine learning is highly iterative, and which makes it highly experimental as well. And it's very common that your machine learning project will involve lots of experiments, and some of them will be bad and some of them will be good. But if you do not keep a track of them systematically, you may miss out on the good experiments which might affect your project a big time. So you might not want to miss out on the good experiments that really come out throughout the entire process. So you might want to keep it gently and strategically, and also in a project friendly way. So then, coming to hyperparameter tuning, when we say we are experimenting with machine learning models, we often implicitly mean that we are experimenting with the different hyperparameters of the machine learning models, or different machine learning models, different hyperparameters of different machine learning models. And there are in fact lots of hyperparameters to take care of, particularly in a very deep neural network. And tuning hyperparameters can be very challenging if you are not keeping track of your hyperparameter tuning experiments effectively. Also, in the real life settings, you will not likely to be using the same data set across your entire project. Your data set is likely to get changed, and it will change. You will not, of course, be training you on the set you had trained it a year back or 2 years back, or let's say just 3 years back. Data is supposed to be changing with the given problem statement, and you should be able to replace your old data set with the new one and further retrain your model. So data set reconstruction and things like that is also a part of applied machine learning and deep learning. And on top of all these things, there's this key performance indicator which actually measures the effectivity and efficiency of your project. There's this time cost trade-off, right? What amount of time your project is taking to be executed, and what's the cost, what are the different costs that are associated while you are executing your project. So time cost trade-off is one of the primary KPIs of in software in projects, so to say. So this KPI, particularly time cost trade-off, prevails all the other things that we just discussed. So moving on, reproducibility crashes is pretty common in machine learning. Reproducibility indeed still an issue when it comes to machine learning, really, because even if you have taken care of all the reproducibility aspects of your machine learning project, things can go wrong, right? So most of the machine learning models, like neural nets, are stochastic in nature. And by stochasticity, I mean with the same configuration and also with the same data set, your neural network's performance can be varying, right? And this randomization is the very flavor of the way neural networks work. It's dependent on the way you, the weights of your neural network is getting initialized and so on, and this is bound to be random. That's supposed to be random. So this stochasticity can harm your project a big time if you do not take proper measures for it. And of course, even if you pump up the version of your favorite machine learning library slightly a bit, your entire project code base might break. So this is an issue. So it's important again to maintain a consistent, you know, dependency manager tool to prevent your project from breaking down and so on. And different machine configuration. Let's say I'm running all my models on a machine that has Titan X GPUs, and my another teammate is running same training scripts on a different GPU. Let's just say that's a K80. So naturally, much fun. Affect the project large. So it's important to maintain consistent machine configuration across your project teams. Moving along. So before I move along, is there any question or should I just carry on?
We don't have have any request, you can come to me.
Okay, thank you. Again, when it comes to machine learning, really, there's this golden partnership in machine learning that we are very much aware of, that that is machine learning models and data. They should be residing in the same place, right? And by code base, I mean the machine learning model. Code base is actually represent different aspects of data. But these two things should be coupled together tightly, because that's the very essence of doing machine learning. But as I mentioned earlier, training data might change over time, but it's less frequent than the change that can happen in your code base. But if your training data changes over time, that's a pain point. Because if your training data is changing, you will have to be retraining the machine learning models, and that can be time consuming, right? And yeah, so as I mentioned, changes in a project's code base are far more frequent, and it's bound to be frequent, right? So these two things needs to be in sync, and a good way to take care of this is to separately version control your training data and separately version control your project's code base. So you might not want to place your data where you would be. You see, we'll come to this separate versioning concept in a moment, but let's just carry on. So checkpointing is another strategy we almost always forget to implement. And to my experience, I have seen many practitioners forgetting about setting up a proper checkpointing strategy. So the very idea of model checkpointing is, let's just say you had this observation. There was this steady decrease in the validation loss, but what if the model that actually caused that steady decrease in your validation loss got lost? So you will have to be training your model again from the scratch, and it might so happen that you are not getting that steady decrease in your validation loss. So to prevent yourself and to prevent your project from these kind of always be set proper model checkpointing strategies. And consider another situation. What if while training your machine learning model, there's some interaction? Let's just say there's some power cut or some natural calamity happening. So what will you do in that case? Even if your model is getting trained in the cloud, there can be some connection issues, there can be some caveats in the cloud infrastructure itself, which might interrupt the model training. So what will we do? This there can be progress of 1-2 days or even months that can be lost here. So it's very important that you set a proper model checkpointing strategy to prevent yourself from these kind of losses. And moving along, like all other software machine learning projects are nothing but software and software engineering and stuff. And a full-fledged machine learning project is not just about models. I mean, you will see from this picture, there are lots of different components in a machine learning project. And as you would have expected, surprisingly or unsurprisingly, the amount of machine learning code is really, really tiny with respect to the other models that you are seeing in this picture, right? So with this different modules in your machine learning project comes different code bases, and with these different code bases there's this need to structure all these code bases in a proper directory format, because you might be working on the machine learning code base only, but there can be another teammate who is suppose working on data verification or configuration, or he or she is working on serving infrastructure and so on. So if you maintain a unified directory structure, it makes it really easier for the entire team to be consistent, also the deployment lifecycle. By the way, this picture is taken from Google's 2015 paper. It's called Machine Learning as the High Interest Credit Card of Technical Debt. I've linked that paper. I highly encourage you to check that out. So as I mentioned, machine learning gives birth to lots of technical dates, lots of ideas, lots of experiments gives birth to this technical date, and not everyone in the team actually deals with machine learning. They might be responsible with other things like data engineering, deployment, web backends and so on, and they do not need to understand everything, right? Just because I am a machine learning engineer, I am not supposed to be knowing everything about web development and stuff and vice versa. And also, there's this tendency towards lack of documentation, as documentation is not always considered so cool. And guy who is responsible for deploying your machine learning model doesn't need to understand how the model was trained. And often, added on top of all these pointers, machine learning code bases are not really easy to debug or easy to review, because there can be niche concepts that you might have incorporated in order to improve your model training. Let's just say you incorporated dropout to enhance the generalization of your neural network, and your teammate who is reviewing your machine learning code base is not yet familiar with dropout. So what will he say then? So if you take care of it in a very project specific way, let's just say when you use dropout, you mentioned it somewhere, you documented it properly as to why you use dropout, what's the background of using dropout and so on, that being you reviewing your code base will be on the same. So that will be much more project friendly. So yeah. This high-interest technical debt caused by machine learning actually hurts the overall development of your machine learning project. And to this end, I highly encourage you all to check out this paper by Google Research. It's again a classic paper which was released in the year of 2015. Make sure you check that out. I have linked this paper in my speaker notes. So moving along, here's a quick summary of the things that we have discussed. So we mentioned that applied machine learning is highly an iterative process, and machine learning projects actually come with this reproducibility crisis, which make it really hard on the people to deploy with a sustainable reproducibility aspects. There's this challenge of versioning data and your project code bases separately. There's this issues with model checkpointing. There can be inconsistent directory structures for different modules of your project, and there can be, of course, high interest technical debt that can be, rise from machine learning and so on. So let's again cut through today's topic. So how should we actually go about structuring machine learning projects? Now, before we actually discuss these pointers, I'd like to say that these are my opinions completely, and some of the opinions are collected from world-class machine learning practitioners like Josh Tobin, Andrei Karpathy, and so on. So I highly encourage question any point, stop me at any point if something's unclear or something you might want to add on. So I'll start with a polished directory structure, because that's what my machine learning projects typically start with. I always start with a very polished directory structure. So here I'm assuming that my machine learning project is based on a web project. So there will be a separate folders for all these different modules of my machine learning project. So it's important to identify these separate elements and start with a boilerplate directory structure, and then modify it as you go along in your project, as you iterate through your project gradually. There will be lots of duplicate code bases, there will be lots of redundant script as well. So at the end of the day, make sure you clean them all up and give it a consistency and a flavor of cleanliness. So I'm assuming my project has these different modules, of course, machine learning projects cannot survive without data. I have a separate directory for data. All the experimentations before I actually deploy my model, before I actually decide on what models should I use. And then I have a web backend, which is actually responsible for deploying my machine learning model, where I typically expose my machine learning model typically as a REST API. There can be some utility scripts which might include a suite of test cases for my project, and then there will be some continuous integration, model building, and model training scripts. So I'm assuming these are the different elements of my machine learning project, and yours can be different, of course. So here's a reference directory structure that I would follow in case I had this different modules in my machine learning project, and this is highly inspired from a lecture by Josh Tobin at this bootcamp called Full Stack Deep Learning. I encourage you to check that out. So as you can see, I'm trying to build an apparel classifier. I'm using the good old fashion MNIST dataset, and I have tried to design the directory structure to aid all the different modules that are there in my machine learning project. So what I'll ask you is just take a moment and go through this directory structure and note any questions that you might have on this. So I'll just allow you some moment so that I can also breathe for some time, and you can also, because TikToks do not necessarily have to put it. As you can see, this is different directory for datasets. This is different directory for models. This is different base directory for developing your neural networks on top of them. There's a different directory for test cases. There's an entirely different directory for serializing your network space, and so on. But I hope this directory structure is beneficial for you, and I'll just proceed to the next slide. So, as I mentioned, there can be different workspace setups, and I'm assuming we all are Pythonistas here. So, for environment management tools, I typically use virtual environment, but I have also listed PPLD as well. This environment will help you design and develop your virtual environments very easily and share them across with your teammates. And also, you might want to use containers like Docker, and you might want to use Kubernetes to orchestrate the entire lifecycle of those Docker containers. So containers are this thing which allow you to package your entire machine learning project and the application in a containerized environment with all its infrastructure setup and dependency, and basically you can take that container and run it on any platform irrespective of anything. So machine learning platforms can be very difficult to devise, especially when they are on-premise. So use of unified machine learning platforms like Floyd Hub makes it really easier for you to experiment rapidly, prototype, and deploy eventually if you are, let's say, developing a proof of concept for your clients and so on. So machine learning models again give birth to a lot of things, because and there will be a lot of experiments in your modeling processes, and there will be many metrics that you will have to take care of. For example, what are the loss and accuracy metrics from the different experiments that you had run? What are the model parameters that you would want to care about? How about the CPU usage, memory footprint, and GPU usage, and so on? Because your client or other stakeholders in the machine learning project that you are working on might want to take a look at this and decide accordingly. So I highly suggest you to check out this tool called Weights and Biases to automatically keep track of these things for you on a hosted environment, okay, which is absolutely shareable with anyone in your teammates and anyone in the world if you might want to do so. So let's just take this example. So again, I didn't have to do anything, but I just had to insert one line of code for generating these kind of plots. These plots are again all generated both locally and on a hosted environment, so that it's very easy to share these things across across your teammates. As I was mentioning, you might want to be able to keep track of your CPU usage while your model is training. What's the memory footprint of your model while it's training? Weights and biases keeps track of all of these things for you. And added on top of that, here's a summary view of all my experiment run for one of my personal projects. So there's this tabular view, there's this summarized view of all my experiments that I had run, and I can include other configuration variables on top of these default variables as well. So as you can see, I ran all of my experiments for 5 bugs. I experimented with different layers, so and also there are other configuration variables as well, but I had to crop them out to fit this whole thing in my screen. And of course, there's this matrix as well. My training loss, my validation loss, what's my training accuracy for a particular experiment, and what's my validation accuracy for a particular experiment. So I didn't have to do anything, but I just used one line of code to keep track of all these things. That too on a online hosted environment. So try it out here. I highly encourage you to try Weights and Biases for your machine learning experiments and projects. It's entirely free. It's an open source Python package, basically. Moving forward, it's very important to, you know, build a mental image of the execution flow of your machine learning project, and I'll explain in a sec. But let me just give you the reason, the primary reason behind it, because you know, there will be lots of different interconnected blocks in a project, and this can be recursive as well. A block can have several sub-blocks as well. So it's very important to keep track of these Lego blocks and build a mental model as to, you know, as to see how these blocks are connected with each other, what's their logical execution flow, to, you know, to be consistent across your development throughout the project. So here's an example of that. So as you can see, this is different tasks which might be there in a machine learning project. It's an NLP-based machine learning project. So there's this separate pipeline for data preparation. There's this separate steps involved there. Then again, a result of a particular step from a particular module, how it's connected to the other module in the project, and so on. And who are all responsible for these modules? Who are the point of contacts for these modules? I mean, this reference structure is taken from my good friends at Floyd Hub. But yeah, you can of course use it as a reference. So this is again, as I mentioned, it's an NLP-based machine learning project. As you can see, there's this task named entity recognition, sentiment analysis, and so on. But as you can see, the output of one particular block is getting fed to another block on a different module. So how these things are connected? So through your entire machine learning project code base, you might get lost if you do not keep a track of this effectively and systematically. So this reference structure is there for you, and it would be great if you could let us know how you liked it. I'm almost there to finish my talk, but I have just a couple of more important points that I think which I'll be discussing. So yeah, as I mentioned in the very beginning of my talk, there's this idea of partial controlling your data and code bases separately, because along with code bases, a machine learning project will also involve data, because it's the thing that fuels your machine learning models. So here's some situations specifically for your training data. Let's just say you need to replace your old training images with newer ones. It of course can happen. You need to add new training images to an already existing training set of images. You suddenly decided that you would incorporate active learning to select interesting test data points to manually label them, and you decided that you would be adding those test data points to your training. So these are some of the situations in which your training data set can be changing. So how do you version control these changes? This might happen that you want to go back to the oldest version of your data set and look for things, how they changed and how certain results were getting produced. So how you would version control your data sets. So it's an important thing to care about. And I'll give you a positive pointer with which you can deal with it effectively. So yeah, of course, version control of your machine learning project's code base remains traditional by using tools like GitHub, GitLab, and things like that. But you might not want to version control your data using this similar tool. So flood of datasets allows you to version control your datasets in a very friendly way. It works exactly like GitHub, but it comes with dedicated functionalities so that you can effectively version control your datasets. I have specified a link to flood of datasets, and I encourage all of you to try it out and let us know.
Sorry, I have to inform you. You have 5 minutes.
Yeah, I know. Okay. I am following this timer.
Okay.
Yeah. So here's a quick summary of the things that we had discussed. So, and here are the two primary things that we did not cover today. So we did not cover how can we effectively design test cases for our machine learning projects. It's very important, because machine learning projects are essentially softwares, and how we should go about model deployment and so on. Maybe next time, maybe in a meetup or a similar event like this. And as I mentioned, I have made my slides available here. It's very simple, bit.ly/izmir-sayak. So here are some references. This article was actually written by me. I would appreciate your feedback on this, and I have these other references as well. And I'd love to get connected with you all and have a chat on deep learning, machine learning, and you can find my coordinates over this link, sayak.dev, and I thank you all of you again.